If I was at the end of the series of talks, I might be saying, and now for something completely different, but I'm at the beginning. So instead, what I'd like you to do is to consider the buildings that we see on the screen here and think about the diversity in the structure and morphology of those buildings. And we think about explaining that diversity often in some of the following ways. So for example, the environment in which they've been built, temperature, the availability of materials, learning of the individuals who have built them, and indeed of cultural traditions. When we come to these constructions, however, we again have some of the similar interpretations for why there's a diversity of the form that these structures take and the materials that they are built with. That include the response by the bird to the environment, to the availability of materials, but we very typically do not consider that there might be a role for learning about the way that these might be built, and we certainly don't consider that they might be the result of cultural traditions. So the question I want to address here today is, how does a bird know what to build then? Where does that come from? If we were to go back to one of the greatest evolutionary biologists, in 1867, Alfred Russel Wallace said, "Birds, we are told, build their nests by instinct, while man constructs his dwelling by the exercise of reason." Yet I've come to the conclusion that not only is it very doubtful, but absolutely erroneous, that it not only deviates widely from the truth, but is, in almost every particular, exactly opposed to it. I believe, in short, that that birds do not build their nests by instinct. So there we are, we have the answer. But come forward to 2024, and we can find this online, which is where we gain most of our information these days. Robins don't need written instructions for building their summer homes. They follow the nest-building blueprints in their brains and instinctively know how to build the perfect structure to hold the eggs they're about to lay. So there we go. My talk is pretty short. That's the answer. But actually, it's going to be a little bit longer than that, because I want to ask the question here in front of you whether or not there is a role for learning in nest building. And what I want to do is to describe to you the four experiments that we've conducted and their outcomes, and leave it to you to decide whether or not there might be a role for learning by birds building their nests. The star of this show here is the zebra finch. It is a small passerine, a small songbird from Australia and Papua New Guinea that has been adapted very well to being held in captivity and indeed is now considered to be domesticated in some parts and is used a lot by behavioural ecologists in the laboratory for asking questions of all sorts of kinds. And here I'm going to ask these birds about nest building and how they go about it. The bird on the left is the male. He's reasonably strikingly coloured, and his mate is on the right. And for the purpose of this, it's a really useful species because they will build in captivity. In this species, it's the male who is the builder, the primary builder. The female may help with the material once it's been brought to the nest cup, but it is the male who does the work. And we can provide these birds with all sorts of kinds of materials of a variety of kinds, and they will attempt to build a nest, some of which are more functional than others. But my first question I want to ask here is whether or not laboratory zebra finches build a nest that is suitable for the ambient temperature. Is it true that birds can build a nest that is suitable for the temperature? So my first experiment, zebra finches built their nests at 14 degrees C or 30 degrees C. And I checked today and I think I'm going to get the numbers right for Fahrenheit, and I think about 57 degrees and somewhere in the mid 80s. If to translate. The birds were given as many pieces of string as they needed to build their nest, and they had babies or did not have babies, depending on whether or not they did that. Once their babies had grown up and fledged, we removed the nest from the birds, and we simply counted the number of pieces of string that the birds had used to build that nest. The data are shown here. Along the bottom is the ambient temperature, so either 14 or 30 degrees, and up the side we counted the number of pieces of string. The blue dot represents the birds that built at 14 degrees, and the red dot represents the birds that built at 30 degrees. And the birds that built at the cooler temperature put significantly more pieces of material into their nest, and by doing so, they warmed the nest. So that was for the very first nest that ever built, and what we did was then to ask the birds to build a second nest. So we switched some of the birds from 14 degrees to build their second nest at 30, and vice versa, some of the birds that had built at 30 degrees built their second nest at 14 degrees. And this is what happened. And, oh dear, it doesn't look as if the birds build to the temperature now. Temperature did not seem to explain at all the number of pieces that the birds of material that the birds had put into their nests. Fortunately, after thinking about this a little bit longer and thinking about some other data we had, it turns out it depends on what had happened with their first nest. And the question was whether or not they had produced live babies from their first nest. And along the bottom, we have whether or not they were successful in doing that or unsuccessful. And up the side is whether or it's the number of pieces that were different. How many more or less pieces did they put into their second nest? The birds that had been successful and produced live babies built exactly the same nest the second time around. And it was the birds that had been unsuccessful that changed and typically put more pieces into their nest, made their nest warmer, and therefore were more likely to produce live babies with their second nest. So the answer to my first question, do they build to the temperature? Yes, they do, for their first nest. But once they have their own experience, then they don't. They use their own experience to decide what kind of a nest to build second time around. Question number two, then, was to ask whether or not birds might learn anything about the structural properties of the materials with which they might build. And here we had two materials, the string that we use, and that might be stiff, or flexible, and on the left-hand side you can see a nest that a zebra finch has built using the stiff material, and one that has been built on the right-hand side with more flexible material. The experiment here was to take, again, a first-time builder, and to offer him a pile of stiff string and a pile of flexible string, and simply ask him what he thought about them, and did he prefer one kind of material over the other. Having done that, we then got some of our birds to build with just the flexible string using 100 pieces. And once he had done that, we gave him the option again to tell us what he thought about the stiff and the flexible string. And the experiment, the last part of the experiment was offering the bird, or in fact giving the bird flexible string and asking him to build an entire nest of that string. And having done that, what did he think about flexible or stiff string? So here we have the data. Along the bottom, we have the three different kinds of experiences with the flexible string, either none, 100 pieces, or an entire nest. And up the side is his preference for stiff string. So the higher the number, the more he prefers the stiff string over the flexible string. When a zebra finch has had no experience with either kind of string, they have a preference for the stiff string over the flexible string, a little bit. But once they've built with 100 pieces, that preference for the stiff string goes up. And indeed, once they've finished an entire nest with flexible string, they want none of it. They want absolutely not to see any more flexible string again. So the question is, why is that? They increasingly avoid flexible string. Why? Well, if we then go and look at how many pieces it takes to build a nest using either flexible or stiff string, we can count that number of pieces for the stiff string, and then we can count the number of pieces that a bird that built a nest out of the flexible string. And what we found was that it takes almost twice as many pieces to build a nest with the flexible string. And what I suggest here is that birds learn to avoid costly materials. Question number three is whether or not builders might learn from others. So we have a first-time builder here, and the useful thing about zebra finches is that they have colour preferences for materials. We're not particularly interested in which colour or why, but they will do this. So we offered our first-time builder pink material or orange material, and in this case, our zebra finch much prefers pink material. Then we get our bird to watch a demonstrator who is now building with the colour of material he did not like. He's building with the orange material. There is pink material there too, but we've tied it down. Not that the naive bird knows that and only sees that the bird is building with the other colour material. Half of the first-time birds got to see a demonstrator who was familiar to them, and half of them got to see a demonstrator who was unfamiliar to them. What did we find? We found that the bird that watched a familiar demonstrator switched his preference from the pink to the orange. Birds, on the other hand, who watched a demonstrator who was unfamiliar to them, essentially ignored the information provided by the demonstrator. So the answer to this question was that builders will learn from others, but only if the bird they watched was familiar. My fourth and final question is whether or not birds might choose the materials that are appropriate for the task. So here we have a zebra finch who is not built before, who has now faced with we either give him a box with a large aperture in the upper picture, or we give him a box with a smaller aperture. And then we give him a pile of material that looks a little bit like this, where there are pieces of hay that have been connected or they've been put together with a piece of wire wound around them. And half of the pieces, the wire is about 10 centimetres long, and half of the pieces, the piece of wire is about 3 centimetres long. And then we look to see what they choose to take into the nest box. Here are the data from the birds that built in the large aperture nest box, and what we have 3 days of experience, and up the side here we have the at the top, if they would take all pieces that were just the long pieces, they would be 10 out of 10. We just look at the first 10 pieces they take, and if they were to take no pieces with the wire that was the long pieces of wire, then they would be 0 at the bottom. And what we see here in this and the dashed line through the middle is where the bird doesn't care. It's taking equally pieces with long and with short into its nest box. And what we found is that the birds that are building in this large aperture box were taking all of the pieces in. It didn't seem to matter how much wire was winding the pieces of hay together. However, the birds that were building with a small aperture box on day one were not taking the pieces that were had the long pieces of wire binding them together. And indeed, on day two, they still were not taking those pieces in. They were strongly preferring the pieces of hay that were wound together with a very small piece of wire. However, by day three, by some more experience, they were taking all of the pieces of hay into the nest box. How were they doing this? Well, we went back and had a look at images of what they were doing. And to begin with, the birds were holding the pieces of material with their bill in the middle of the pieces, and they switched across time to holding the pieces at the end. So the birds that had a small aperture box could eventually take all of the pieces into the box. So the birds learnt how to handle material across the course of this experiment. That was a bit of a whistle-stop tour through a handful of the experiments that we've been doing, but I'd like to suggest that increasingly we are finding evidence of learning being involved in how these animals on the right-hand side are putting together their nests. I just want to take you very briefly now to southern Africa, to the Kalahari, to our field site at Swalu, and some work we've completed recently with white-browed sparrow weavers, with the bird shown here. And you can see in the image on the right-hand side lots of sort of blobby structures, and those are roosts built by these birds. White-browed sparrow weavers are cooperatively breeding species where there's a dominant pair. So the male and the female are the ones who do all the breeding, and their young stay. Once they've reached fledging, they stay to help mum and dad raise the next brood. So the families can be 10 to 12 birds. And what we looked at, and they also build a lot. So the tree that's in that right-hand picture is a tree from just one family group. A bit of a close-up to these structures looks like this, and this is Maria Tejal Ramos, one of my colleagues, showing you that an entrance to this, the structure, they're an inverse U-shaped structure with an entrance tube and an exit tube. In fact, the bird goes in and only one bird occupies them, But the birds go in fact, and turn around and sit in the middle, and they come out the entrance tube. They use the exit tube in the way that a garderobe, I think, used to be used in castles. On the right-hand side are some sort of closer images of what these things look like, but they are, in fact, a U-shaped tube. So what we did is to do two things. We videoed the building of these birds, and we also measured the structures because there were lots of them. What our video data showed was that life was reasonably complex. It turns out that all of the birds in a family will cooperate together to build these structures. So there could be a dozen birds building together a single structure. We don't know yet quite how they're managing to do that. However, we also have some data on the structures themselves, and we've measured all sorts of things about them, the length and of the entrance, the exit, the total length, the angle between the entrance and the exit, the width and the diameter of exit and entrance. And what we found is shown here. And what we see here are for every family, so we have 43 families represented here, and the distribution there are of basically the morphology, a composite of the morphology of the structures that family builds. And what we saw was that each family is building structures that are slightly different from other families. What we found that was even more striking was that across years, the families are building structures that are more similar to their own structures than they are to any other family at this site. And we started to talk about them building something with their own architectural style. We looked to see whether temperature could explain the variation that that we saw, that my family builds structures of a particular dimensions that are slightly different to your family's. It's not temperature. It's not the materials that they build with, and it's not the genetics. We know the genetic relatedness across all of the individuals in these families, but it's not that either. So for the moment, we're going to suggest that we have provided the first evidence that building by birds might be evidence for cultural traditions. And so I want to come back to this and end here with a suggestion that the structures on the right-hand side are not entirely the result of the birds' instincts, but that in fact they are built the way they are because the birds learn about materials, they learn from other individuals. Indeed, families might have their own architectural traditions that they pass down through that family. And with that, I will finish. Thank you.